Good evening, everyone. I am glad to welcome Dr. Ashiba, Head of the Department, CSE, for being a great support to initiate this webinar. And I welcome our organizers, Mr. Sampath Kumar, Assistant Professor, CSE, and Mrs. Gayatri, Assistant Professor, CSE, and all other faculty members. And now I welcome our presenters and our student friends and all other attendees who have joined us to enlighten this session. Once again, good evening all. Now, I affably invite Mr. Sampath Kumar, Assistant Professor, CSE, to initiate this session.
Okay. Thank you, Sharmila. Hope I am audible.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Sharmila. Thank you very much, Ajay. Okay, my beloved student friends, faculty members from various institutions across India. Good afternoon once again. This is Sampath Kumar, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Sir Ishwar College of Engineering, Coimbatore. I welcome you all to another exciting webinar. And today's webinar is on quantum computing. This is the third webinar on the series of the webinar. And today is a very important webinar to all of us because till now, okay, we have used our traditional computer, which is dealing with zeros and ones, okay. The days of zeros and ones is going to over soon, okay. And the modern day computer, which is quantum computer, is going to take over the world now. Every day, we create a volume of data in order to adequately process it all. To extract meaning from it, we require much more computing power, which cannot be promised by our traditional binary computers. That's why we need quantum computers to step in to save the day. Today's webinar is going to be presented by Mr. Ajay Desigan and Mr. Gokul, who is from third year computer science and engineering department. Both are very bright and brilliant students. They have done many projects in AR, VR, and even they have submitted some projects to Smart India Hackathon, and we are awaiting selection committee of Smart India Hackathon to review their projects. Apart from those projects, they have submitted many other projects to our college. They have completed many projects to our college. And with this brief introduction, on behalf of Department of Computer Science and Engineering and Sri Ishwar College of Engineering, I call upon Mr. Ajay Desigan and Mr. Gokul to deliver the webinar on quantum computing. Thank you very much, guys. Ajay Desigan.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome, Ajay Desigan. Welcome, Gokul.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, friends. Glad to meet everyone here. Myself, Ajay Desigan, and here is my good friend, Gokul. We are here to explain about quantum computing.
Okay, hi everyone. This is Gokul from Sri Ishwar College of Engineering. I think you people know our topic of today is quantum computing. This topic is little high to understand, so we'll try to make breakdown concepts as simple as possible.
Hope all are eagerly waiting to know what is quantum computing. So without any delay, come on guys, let's begin the session.
Guys, we are going to take this session as a conversation between me, myself, and as well as Ajay. So we'll start the session now. Ajay, can you give key idea about quantum basics?
Sure. First, let's see what is quantum. The word quantum deals with quantum particles. It describes the behavior of a particle or energy in a very microscopic scale. Quantum particles are subatomic particles, for example, electrons, photons, etc. Okay, now, does quantum mechanics differ from classical mechanics? Come, let's see that. Thank you. Imagine this. Consider you are having a ball in your hand. Now, throw them upwards. What happens? After reaching a certain height, the ball reaches zero velocity and comes back to you. This is simple because we have experienced it many times in our life or have seen them. Now, consider an electron of a hydrogen atom. If you threw it upwards, will you be able to get the same result? Well, we don't know because we haven't experienced throwing an electron. To put it in simple words, measurable and recordable object obeys classical mechanics, whereas quantum particles follow quantum mechanics because they cannot be measured or recorded. Also, it is easy for a quantum particle to separate information, but it is not so for macro objects. That's why there is a lot of difference between classical mechanics and quantum mechanics.
Yeah, Jay, you're right. They say quantum particles have dual nature. Is it so?
Yeah, my friend. These particles exhibit characteristics of both wave and particle. Doesn't it sound interesting?
Yeah, that sounds tricky to imagine. Is there any proof of that?
Of course there is. We have learned double slit experiment from Young's. Do you remember?
Yeah, I think so. I can remember it some. But can you give a recap of that experiment?
Anything, friend. So, Young's double slit experiment. This is an experiment to prove that a particle in quantum exists both as a wave and as a particle. So, let's see what the experiment is. So, the double slit experiment is a very mysterious experiment till date. The experiment proves the duality of certain particles. Consider a slit. It is a small opening through which an electron can pass through when it is fired from an electron gun. So, what the scientist thought was, when the electron passes through the slit, it would hit, and this is a screen which would record when the electron hits and it would create an impact in the screen. So, when the experiment was initiated, the scientist was surprised and predicted and saw an unpredictable output. Instead of passing through the hole and hitting the screen directly, they found a pattern formed in the screen. So, this is an interference pattern formed in the screen. Can you imagine this? A particle, when passing through these two slits, how can they exhibit such an interference pattern? It's hard to imagine, right? Then they came to a conclusion that it is only possible if an electron exhibits a wave nature so that it forms such a pattern. The center forms the huge amount of pattern because of many constructive waves in it. Then they kept an observer to observe how the electron passes through these slits. But when it was observed, it is seen that the electron passes through the slits and hits directly on the screen as expected before. So, after these many confusions, they kept on repeating the experiment and they came to a conclusion after several observations. So, they observed two things. Before anything is observed or measured, fascinating.
Yeah, okay. It's really an experiment of mystery. Am I audible to everyone?
Yeah, friend. Yeah, Google, you are right. Also, quantum computing can be understood easily if we can know basics about superposition and quantum entanglement. So here is my good friend Gokul to explain you about them.
Okay, sure. Before seeing what is superposition and what is quantum entanglement, let's have a quick glance about history of quantums. I think you people are very familiar with the word autumn. The word autumn is derived from the Greek word autumnus, which means indivisible. Indivisible is nothing but where a particle cannot be divided into two is called autumn. But later we came to know it can be further subdivided into protons, neutrons and electrons. There exists a usual way of duplicating an atom. Now, I'm going to explain this concept by using an example called a football ground. Now people, you can imagine whatever I say. Now, imagine a football ground with a tennis ball in the center. The circumference of the football ground is the orbit of the electrons. And the tennis ball is the nucleus. So, we have a huge space in between them. But when we see an atom in an electron microscope, we won't see a single electron but a cloud of electrons. This is due to the fast movement of the electron. So this may sound a little tricky, so let me explain this with a video demonstration. Now, imagine the picture as I said as a football ground. The black center part is called the nucleus, which is nothing but you imagine as a tennis ball. And the orange color cloudy particles, which is revolving around that atom, or you imagine as a football ground, is called as electron. So, this ability of the electron to be in multiple places at the same time is called as superposition. That means it can be at any position at any time in multiple states. For better understanding, let me give an example. Hit a tuning fork hard. It vibrates at a high speed. It seems like there is multiple stem for the fork, but it appears so due to its high speed. Take another example called a coin. If you flip a coin, you cannot able to finalize that whether the coin has to be end a conclusion with a head or a tail while it is in a motion position. So, you cannot say that the coin is going to end with heads or tail while it is in a superposition. The superposition is nothing but when you flip a coin, the coin that is in a motion state is called a superposition. Whether it can be head or whether it can be tail. So, you can take this as comparatively with our bits. Bits are called zeros and ones. We can take zeros as off and ones as on. So, in superposition, we can have two states as well as zeros and ones at the same time. That is the good advantage of quantum computing. I think you will be able to know what is superposition from this example. The property of being able to exist in multiple states at the same time is called superposition. Now, let's get into the topic called quantum entanglement. In a simple way, it is just the link between two particles. When entangled particles remain connected, the action performed by one affects the other and is inverse to each other. So, as you see in the presentation, let's see the action. Consider the first particle spins from top to bottom, the second particle spins from bottom to up. So, you consider the two atoms which you see in the presentation as electron A and electron B. Now, if electron A spins from top to bottom, then the electron B will spin to bottom to up. Only then we can create a relation between two electrons. So, if one space is one, the other electron will be zero. To say in other words, if one state of electron is on, the other state of electron will be off. You can imagine with the gate examples also using classical computers. Now, let's see a famous imaginary experiment called Schrödinger's cat experiment. Okay, I think after we're finishing this experiment, you can get a clear idea about what is quantum entanglement is. Now, take two boxes. Each box has a cat, a contained poison gas, and a switch by which entangled particles are in contact. If the particle reaches the bottom of the switch gets activated and the poisonous gas gets released. Considering the two boxes, the probability of the cat surviving is 50% and the probability of the cat which is going to die is 50%. Since the particle is entangled, the particle is nothing but the electron, the two each electrons inside two boxes are connected to each other. So if one state is on, the other state will be off. So that is nothing but if one state is in one state, the other state will be zero. So if the let's keep the boxes name as box A and box B. We can assume like this. So if the cat in the box A is dead, and we can say it surely that the cat in the box B will be alive. If the cat in the box B is dead, then we can surely say if the cat in the box A will be alive, because it is of 50% probability. Since the electrons inside these two boxes are entangled, they behave as zeros and ones at the same time, which is called superposition, and these two related to each other, which is able to control the concepts called quantum entanglement. Now, Einstein calls this as a spooky action in distance, because consider an entangled particle, one placed in India and another in America. As they are entangled, they share their information even at a larger distance. Since the data travels faster than light and is opposite to relativity, he didn't accept this. But this is going to become our advanced future technology in our technological world. So this is what was caught in this cat experiment, which explains about both the quantum entanglement and superposition. I think you've got some idea and brief idea about these concepts.
Gokul, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Ajay. Can everyone hear us? You people can respond.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, fine.
Sorry, I was having an echo issue. Okay, now let's see, why do we go for quantum computers from classical computers? First, let's see what a classical computer is. Have you ever wondered how classical computers perform so fast? This is because the number of transistors are millions in our computer. The transistor basically acts as an on or off switch to pass the electron flow. For instance, the iPhone 11 Pro has a 7 nanometer A13 bionic chip. It is said that it contains about 8.5 billion of transistors. To compare the size of a modern transistor, it is about 500 times less than the size of red blood cells in our body. Isn't that great? But there is a physical limitation for these transistors. Before seeing this limitation, let's see the concept called Moore's Law. Gordon Moore is the co-founder of Intel. In 1965, he postulated this Moore's Law. The law states that the number of transistors that can be packed to a given unit space increases for every 2 years. This was one of the famous practical law which happened for 2 years, but it stopped in 2015. In 2015, Moore himself told that the law is dying. Why did he say so? Now, here comes another concept called quantum tunneling. So, as we reduce the size of a transistor, it also directly reduces the size of the barrier in it too. So, as the barrier reduces, it cannot stop the flow of the electrons passing through the resistors. So, the electron can tunnel through the barrier because the electron does not consider the barrier at that very small size. So, this leads to current leakage, which can result in heating of the entire chip.
Hope you had a clear idea. Now, let me tell about quantum computers. As seen earlier, quantum computing is defined as the use of quantum mechanical phenomena such as superposition and entanglement to perform computation. Computers that perform quantum computation are known as quantum computers. A quantum computer does not replace a classical computer. Since we achieve the processing power of classical computers, we need computers with more processing capacity. So we go for quantum computers. Now, I will explain what is quantum computing by comparing it with the classical computer. A classical computer uses bits for processing. I think you people may know what are bits. Bits are nothing but zeros and ones inside our processor. The zeros or ones get stored using the transistor which is contained inside our processor. We have billions of transistors inside each processor. A classical computer uses these bits for processing, whereas a quantum computer uses qubits. Classical computer uses bits for processing, where a quantum computer uses qubits. Qubits is nothing but an electron or photon which is in superposition. Quantum bits for processing. In classical computers, we use logic gates. I think you people are very familiar with logic gates. For example, I will take an OR gate. And if we have two inputs in it, if we have an input of 0 and 0, we will get the output as 0. For example, if we have input of 1 and 1, we will have input 1. And as soon as for 1, 0 and 0, 1, I think you will know about it. But in quantum computers, we use quantum gates. In logic gates, we give definite input and get a definite output that is either 0 or 1. But in quantum computers, we give superposition as input. Superposition. I have explained what is superposition in just few minutes ago. Superposition is nothing but zeros and ones can be present at multiple states at the same time and often superposition as output. Since the output contains right and wrong results due to ones and zeros at the same time, we use Grover operator method to eliminate the wrong results. So, let me demonstrate it with a video to get a clear idea about it. So, here we have a good video. I think you people have familiar with this maze gate, where we start with the source and we are going to reach the destination with a specific path and we should find that path. Now, I'm going to explain this example by comparing classical computers and quantum computers. In classical computers, we can have only one input at a time. So, it will start from the source and it will select one path and it will go into the path to check whether we can reach the destination or not. If we can't reach the destination, it will backtrack it and it will read to the source path again and again it will flow through the other path. And finally, if it reaches the destination, it will find the path and it will give us the solution. But this process takes a long time because we have to flow into the each and every path and we have to find the solution in classical computers. But whereas in quantum computers, we have a special advantage in this. I said quantum computers works on two principles. One is superposition and other is quantum entanglement. Superposition is nothing but we can able to handle each and everything at the same state as zeros and ones at the same time. So, in quantum computers, the processor, the qubit, will check each and every part which is available at the same time, and it will fetch the solution as soon as in a fraction of seconds possible. So that is the great advantage of quantum computers, where we lose it in our classical computers. I think you people have a clear idea about classical computer and quantum computer after I am explaining this example. I hope so. So let's take a complex problem to calculate the time complexity for classical and quantum computers. Now I'm going to explain about an algorithm called Shor's algorithm to explain the time complexity. And this is called Shor's algorithm, where M, a number got by the product of P and Q, which are two larger prime numbers. Here, P and Q are nothing but two larger prime numbers. Here, the problem is to find P and Q when M is given. The problem is that the multiplication number which is multiplied by using two larger prime numbers will be given, and your process is to find the larger prime number, and you have to find which is P and which is Q. That is the solution you need to provide by processing this. So we can clearly see the time taken by the two computers. While a classical computer takes around 28 into 10 to the power 21 years to complete to fetch the solution for this problem. As you can see in the screen, the time complexity for this problem for a classical computer is exponential, order of n to the power 1 by 3 to the logarithm of 2 by 2 to the power n. It takes 28 into 10 to the power 21 years. But you will have a great shocking surprise. When it comes to quantum computers, you can see the time complexity. It can solve this problem in just order of n cube time complexity in just 100 seconds. So this is the big advantage of quantum computers. Quantum computers are used to process larger data which cannot be done in classical computers easily. Thus, quantum computer processes simple and complex input and gives the output of multiple cross possibilities within short span of time. That's it about quantum computers.
That was enlightening, Gopi. I enjoyed it. So, as you saw, this is the power of quantum computers. In a simple representation, let's take classical computers take 2 into n order to solve the problem, whereas a quantum computer takes the order of 2 power n to process, where here n stands for number of qubits. This seems to be very light, as you just say it's just 2 power n. So let me tell you a short story so that you can have a clear imagination to know how powerful an exponential is. So the story is known as chess grain story. The story goes like, the person who invented chess game presents it to the king. The king was pleased and asked what he wants in return. The inventor says, give a grain of rice in the first day. So the inventor says, give a grain of rice on the first day for the first square, and double it for the next square for the next day, and so on. He keeps it doubling for every square in the chessboard. So by the end of the month, he would have more rice than we can eat in our entire lifetime. By the end of 64 days, the inventor had 641 billion metric tons of rice, which is more than that of Mount Everest. Isn't that a power of exponential?
Wow, what a massive ending, Ajay. Ajay, I don't know how does a quantum computer looks like, and our friends too don't know what and how a quantum computer looks like. But can you explain how a quantum computer looks like?
Sure, friend. That's what we are here for. So, unlike other computers, quantum computer looks very different. This is how a quantum computer looks. It occupies a room. But unlike normal computers, these computers have constraints. First, quantum computers are placed at the bottom of a refrigerator called as dilution refrigerator, where the temperature is maintained at 15 millikelvin, but the temperature in outer space is very much greater than this Kelvin. The outer space temperature is 2.7 Kelvin, whereas the temperature maintained here is 0.01 Kelvin. So it is even more colder than outer space. The next is, it had to be placed in vacuum in order to avoid quantum vibrations. So what is a quantum vibration? Consider if you pass a light through this quantum computer, the light emits photon particles. Even those quantum photon particles can create a disturbance in the process. So we keep them in vacuum to avoid those quantum vibrations. But I have an idea. Let me share with you. Consider computers 30 years ago. They too occupied the size of a room. But it's now in our hand. Who might know? Maybe after 30 years, even quantum computers come handy. So let's wait and see.
Okay, that's really incredible.
Yeah, my friend. Quantum is of course really incredible. Google, can you brief about what is quantum supremacy?
Yeah, let me brief you and friends about what is quantum supremacy. Generally, the data of quantum computer is processed by classical computers. At a stage where classical computer struggles or fails to process the quantum computer data, then it is called as quantum supremacy. In other words, if a quantum computer is greater than classical computer, it is called quantum supremacy. So, to explain about what is quantum supremacy and to make you understand what is quantum supremacy, we have two case studies which makes us easier to understand. The case studies are that Google claims to achieve supremacy. That is one case study, and the other case study is a Volkswagen group of companies use quantum computing in an application. So let's have a brief explanation about these two case studies. First, let's start with Google. Here, Google claims to achieve supremacy. Google said that they have built a 54-qubit quantum computer in which one qubit failed. When the quantum computer generated random numbers continuously. So, what the Google have done is, they have tested with a classical computer of a process of generating random numbers continuously. The number generated here would take 10,000 years for a classical computer to generate them. So, but the time taken by quantum computer was just 200 seconds to generate those huge random numbers. So, from here you can able to know what advantage does quantum computing have. A classical computer needs 10,000 years to generate random numbers, which is equal to the same number of random numbers can be generated by quantum computer in just 200 seconds. Can you people imagine how fast it is? But IBM, one of the leading tech giant company in quantum computing, claims that the random numbers might not be 10,000 years, but can be around 2.5 days. But eventually, other companies agreed to the latter that even if the computer solves the work of 2.5 days in 200 seconds, then quantum computing is a great achievement while comparing to classical computers. So let's get on with the next case study called where Volkswagen group of companies use an application of quantum computers. They developed an algorithm to ensure that people reach the destination as quickly as possible. This algorithm predicts 30 to 45 traffic volumes and then send the respective vehicle and individual optimized route to avoid congestion. For every 120 seconds, it checks for the optimal route. Thus, the quantum computing distributed them the entire network, thus not causing any further congestion. The only difference here from other navigation systems is that they provide the optimal route that they obtain as output from quantum computer. I think so you cannot be able to understand anything while I am saying this. I will explain in simple words. In classical computers, we will use an algorithm called traveling salesman algorithm to find a path from a source to destination which is shortest path available. what a traveling salesman algorithm does is it will start from the source and it will reach the destination by each and every available way it have. To make it a clear idea, it is same as an example I'm explaining you in maze game. Maze game is same as traveling salesman. It will check all possible ways it can have and it will give the output as the shortest possible way which we can travel to get to the destination properly. But what quantum computers do is it can able to check all the ports at the same time and can give the solution in a fraction of seconds, which is a cakewalk for quantum computers. So these are the great applications of quantum computers which might be true and which may be very useful in our future days.
That was a really great time application, friend. Can you explain why other applications of quantum computers?
Yeah, let's see them. There are many applications, but list a few. First, let's see how we can secure data. That means security. We can see how quantum computing is used superbly in security area. Since almost everything is a probability in quantum computing, we use that quantum uncertainty to create a private key for encrypting messages. As it is uncertain, hackers could not copy the key perfectly. You might have to loss of physics to hack the key, which is almost impossible. Now, for example, take a bank locker of yours. So you set a password of, for example, 4242 is your password. If a hacker wants to hack your password using classical computers, then it is a definite constant number of a password. So he can be easily able to crack that password using that four numbers generator. The minimum number of possible numbers are 9999 times all the possible numbers. So he can, using that process speed, he can able to hack the your bank password very easily. But in quantum computing, we involved with superposition and quantum entanglement. But we will hone have a constant password for the bank locker. It will appear in two states at the same time. It can be either zeros and ones. It can appear in two states at same time. So the hacker finds difficult to unlock the bank locker by which is building using quantum computing. So if you want to hack the bank locker which is processed using quantum computing, he needs to break the law of quantum physics to hack it. So it will be very helpful in security areas. So quantum computing plays a good role in security areas while coming to the future. So next is here is healthcare and medicine. Design and analysis of drug development is a challenging problem today. This is because exactly describing and calculating all the quantum properties of all the atoms and molecules is a difficult task even for supercomputers. But a quantum computer can do better as it operates on the same quantum property. So further, quantum simulation for drug development could lead to cures for certain diseases. There's nothing but researchers use and see into the microscope of drugs which is they are used to clean into atoms and molecules. They will have what effect that a single atom have. They have to research what effect that a single molecule have. So it will be easy for the researchers to find it while they use quantum computers, because quantum computers also deals with the same atom level of computing. So it will be very easy for a researcher to develop drugs than using researchers using classical computers. So quantum computers plays a great role in healthcare and medicine. Here we have an example called beryllium hydride. We have four electrons of beryllium and two hydride. So for a classical computers to make this solution to get how a drug related to the disease will be affected, for classical computer to find this solution, it may take up to 40,000 into 40,000 matrix to be solved to fetch the solution. But if we use quantum computers for this, it will fetch the solution in a fraction of second. That's really impressive, I think so. And this is the great advantage of quantum computing.
That was really impressive, friend. So let me add few other applications. First, teleportation of information. Yeah, friends, you heard it right. We can transfer information from one point to another, that is from source to destination, without physically transmitting the information. This might sound a little science fiction to you, but it's truly possible. Since particle gets entangled across the space and time, a small change even in a minute in a source particle can create a ripple and impact the other. So the information will reach very quickly. As explained earlier by Gokul, Einstein thought since the data sent by the entangled particle, the data transfer rate is more than the speed of light, it is opposite to his relative theory. So Einstein opposed it. Also, with this concept, there also arises a new concept called quantum internet. So the final application, database search. Instead of explaining the concept, let me give you a thought process. Imagine you are having a phone book with millions of contacts in it. The names and numbers are in unsorted order. So think you are asked to retrieve the name of the person with the phone number given. Consider a classical computer is solving this problem. It needs to at least check 500,000 contacts to retrieve the answer. But whereas a quantum computer needs only 1,000 checks to produce a result. Can you imagine how fast a quantum computer processes from a classical computer?
Yeah, those are wonderful applications. Ajay, I have another doubt, and I think our fellow friends also have the same doubt. Ajay, is it possible for us to use quantum computers?
Yeah, my friend. If you can actually simulate the process, you can use a simulator to process our big data and you can arrive at the solution in seconds because it's a quantum computer. If you have a system and a proper internet connection, you can run your application. So, D-Wave. D-Wave is a Canadian-based company. It offers a service called Leap Service, which is a cloud-based quantum computing, quantum application environment. It gives developer real-time access to work on quantum computers.
Yeah, sure. It is a cloud-based service where the process which cannot be take solutions from your classical computers, you can go through the internet and you can access this D-Wave to get better solution from it and you can access it in your same classical computers. That's a useful one.
Yeah. Also, you can log in with your email and you will get a dashboard where you will be allowed, for example, if you take AWS service, they will be giving a free time for certain hours. Similarly, if you consider this simulator, they will be giving duration for very few seconds. So why are they giving a free trial only for few seconds? Guys, this is a quantum computer. It processes lakhs of data within a few seconds. So I think a very few seconds is more than enough for solving a huge amount of data.
Yeah, friends, but the more you learn about quantum, the more confusing it gets. I think it is the mindset of your people now. What's your opinion?
Yeah, that's true, friend. The more you know about quantum, the more confusing it gets. There is also a famous saying in quantum mechanics. If you think you understand quantum mechanics, you don't understand quantum mechanics. This is not a joke, but this is how they say. But don't worry, you will get the hang of quantum physics.
Yeah, I didn't expect that. Okay, friends. Hope we explained a vast topic which is very tough to understand as simple as possible and made your satisfaction. I think so, we have made your satisfaction and I think you people have at least gained some knowledge about what is quantum computing and what role it is going to play in future technological world.
Yeah, quantum physics is really a very vast topic, friends. Within a short time, we could only explain a drop in the ocean. If you really find quantum physics to be interesting, I would recommend you to study. Thank you.
Thank you all and I think so. If your people have any doubts or any clarification, and if we're able to know that concepts, we can feel pleasant to help you on clearing your doubts. Is there any queries?
Thank you, Mr. Gokul, and thank you, Mr. Adhir Desigan. It was a wonderful session. And now it's time for Q&A session. If you have any questions, kindly post it up in the chat box.
Yeah, friend, please feel free to ask questions.
Bharat, what do you mean by qubits? So, qubits stands for quantum bits. So, what a quantum bit is, as I mentioned earlier, consider you're having a transistor. It will have two bits, 0 or 1. What you have to do is you have to send a signal. What are the possibilities? Either you can on, off, because only 0 and 1 exist. If you are given with 2, you can do 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. So, as the number of transistors increases, the number of computational power increases. Whereas in quantum computing, you do not use bits, you use qubits. Qubits exist in superposition. That is, you won't give ones and zeros like in gates. It's really tough to imagine, but let me explain to make you imagine. The atom will exist in, as Gokul explained earlier, it spins both upwards and downwards. So, when you are giving qubit as input, it won't be taken as ones or zeros, it will be taken as both 1 and 0 and process, and it will give you an output with the same superposition. So, for example, you have to do a password check. The password is 0011. A classical computer does is it checks for 0000, 0001. It checks all the combinations, and at last when it finds the right match, it gives the output. But what a quantum computer does it, since it takes zeros and ones at the same time, you will get an output with a correct and wrong results. So as I explained earlier, we use a method called Gruer method. So what it does is, it removes or it eliminates the wrong results to produce the right results. So is it okay, Bharat? Did you get something?
Thank you, Ajay. And here is your next question. Do you have any sites that can be referred to learn more about quantum computing?
I think we don't have any specific sites for learning quantum computing. Still, it's a research. But I would suggest you to refer tech giant companies like IBM, Google, Intel, because they study quantum computers for almost years and they put them in real-time application. So quantum physics is not a topic that you can learn from a single site. As I mentioned earlier, the more you get to know about physics, the more confusing it gets. So you have to link what you have learned from each and every site, then only you will get to know how quantum physics works.
Thank you, Mr. Ajay. And here is your next question from Dharanita. And the question is, what is the difference between normal computer and quantum computer?
Okay, I can explain this question. So, in normal computer, in processors, we will have transistors. In transistors, we will have nothing but zeros and ones. So, if you want to process any processors in a normal computer, you can able to give at a time only a single order. Either you can have zero or either you can have one. But you cannot have two things at the same time. But in quantum computer, it deals with superposition. So you can have zeros and ones at the same time. For example, I will explain it with the OR gate. In OR gate, we can take two inputs. So we have, what are all the possible inputs? We have 0, 0, and the possible outcome is 0. We have 1, 0, and the possible outcome is 1. And we will have 0, 1, and the possible output is 1. And finally, we have 1, 1, and the possible output is 1. So let us assume this one process takes 1 second to compute in normal computer. So in normal computer, to process these four different inputs, it will take 4 seconds to fetch the solution. But in quantum computer, it deals with superposition. So it will take all the four inputs, that is 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0. It will take all these four positions in superposition, and it will fetch all these solutions and outputs at the same time, which you can fetch solution in just 1 second. So that is the advantage of quantum computer. So that is the difference between the normal computer and quantum computer. I think, Dharnita, you can able to imagine what I'm saying, and I think cleared your doubt.
Thank you, Mr. And here is a question from Karthik KN. Mr. Karthik KN, and the question is like, what is the advantage of quantum computer to normal computer? I hope you have answered it before.
Yeah, the answer given by Gokul is the same answer for his question.
Thank you, and we'll go with
KN, are you clear?
Here is a question from Rishi, and the question is, is there any specific algorithm for a superposition process in quantum computing? Can I repeat it? Is there any specific algorithm for a superposition process in quantum computing?
Sorry, my friend. I don't know whether there exists any specific algorithm for superposition. Since it's very minute, the only view, for example, if you want to know the characteristics of an electron, you have to see through an electron microscope. You can't do a coding to view how a electron spins. Only through a mechanical device, you can view how an electron spins. As I showed in the video, the atom, there is a huge difference. There is a large gap from the nucleus and the electron. So the electron rotates at a higher speed. It creates a electron cloud. You can't, as Gokul explained, hit a tuning fork. It vibrates at a high rate. So it seems like you will have multiple tuning fork with the same stem. So that's not any algorithm for predicting this. It's only full and full mechanics. That's why we are using quantum mechanics in quantum computing and not quantum computing in quantum mechanics. So do you get an idea, Rishi?
So I have a point to add on this. I have explained about Shor's algorithm, right? So that is one algorithm which is used by Google to achieve that Google quantum supremacy. I said that Google quantum supremacy is achieved, and it is said that Google has achieved it. So they said they can process it in 3 minutes 15 seconds, what a classical computer takes 10,000 years to do it. So one of the algorithm where Google used this is Shor's algorithm. And other than that algorithm, everything that they solved is based on all of mechanics and quantum physics. And if you want more about to know about this, you can refer YouTube, you can refer Google's channel itself for how they have worked for to achieve this quantum supremacy. You can refer it and you can gain a great knowledge about that. You have it in Google channel inside the YouTube. So you can refer it for it.
Thank you, Mr. Gokul, and thank you, Mr. Ajay. Here is our next question. And here, Mr. Mohammed Yazan is sharing his opinion, and we want to know your speech. And the question is like,
I read that. Can you please explain it, Mr. Mohammed? Just I want to know how you are saying quantum computer is lesser compared to classical computer.
Hello, sir. Myself, Mohammed Yasin.
Yeah, welcome, Mohammed.
Sir, to my knowledge, when I refer to most of the sources, they say that classical computers are more efficient when compared to quantum computers. It is because when multiple inputs are taken at a time, the efficiency of calculation will be great in quantum computers, but the efficiency of accuracy, it will be less. What is your opinion about that?
Yeah, that's true. That's what we explained earlier. When you come to quantum computing, it's not a certain output. It's the probability of outputs. That's what you explained. If you take logical gates, you would give definite inputs and you would get a definite outputs. Well, that is for certain. But if you take a quantum computers, you would give superposition as input. Since it exists both at zeros and ones at the same time, you would also get an output with zeros and ones at the same time. So, as you said, we can only calculate the probability of the output. As they say, there is a heads and tails for a coin. Quantum computers too have their withdrawals. But when you see in the long run, for example, wait, let me show you. Mr. Yasin, can you see this?
Yes, sir.
So consider here, the scenario is you have to calculate a 40 cross 40 matrix. So do you think it's a classical computer can really process and produce output in a very few amount of time?
No, sir, but my point is that for the practical usage, this can only be done for some calculation or rough estimation, right, sir?
Yeah, that's what we are saying. A quantum computer doesn't replace our classical computers. Even if it's 50 years from now, we will be using our same classical computers for our own purpose. The application part of quantum computers is like, as we said earlier, the quantum supremacy achieved by Google, or the other case of Volkswagen car company. So that's not a personal use. That's a company use where it uses those huge amount of data to create, say, a customer satisfaction. So that's not a quantum computer. Is not a personal computer. A quantum computer is a computer which calculates a big amount of data and produces you the probability of answers, so that you can arrive at a conclusion and give your customers the best response you can give. So that's where the real application of quantum computers lies. So a quantum computer is never going to replace classical computers. The work of classical computers will be going on as such.
I have a point to add on your point. You said, while coming to accuracy, quantum computers are less efficient. Partially, I can agree with your point, but quantum computer has an operator called Gruber operator, where you can minimize the assumption or can get assured the solution as much as possible, as much as the inputs, number of inputs you give, it can give assured solution as where classical computers can also give using an operator called Gruber operator. But when it is compared to classical computers, nowadays it is less efficient. I agree with your point.
Okay, sir.
Thank you,
Mr. Gokul, and thank you, Mr. Ajay. And there is your next question, and it's from Mr. Jayakrishna Kumar. And the question is, like a transistor in classical computer, what is the interface? What is the interface you can use for quantum computing? He means like a physical device to manipulate magnetic spins of electrons.
So, if you want to see the spin of an electron, if I'm assuming that's your question, well, we have apparatus and not, for example, it's not the size of your mobile phone. You have an apparatus larger in size to see the spins of an electron. It is also said that you can view the, an electron spins both up and down at the same time. So with the help of a larger apparatus, you could view that electron. Since electron has certain magnetic properties, when you are placed in an EMF, an electromagnetic field, the spin of an electron can be controlled using those apparatus. So, as I said, 30 years from now, might be the size of those apparatus might reduce, but for now, it's still a bigger apparatus. So, did you get an idea, Mr. Jay Krishna Kumar? Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rajan. Yeah. And here is your next question. And the question is, we have got a lot of great steps inside a quantum computer, but are you in a stage to for our day-to-day concept?
Okay, Mr. Sachin, as I mentioned earlier, for our personal use, we will be going with classical computers and not with quantum computers. Quantum computers replaces where big companies, for example, take Amazon, Google, IBM, they have very huge amount of data since they have many number of customers. In order to process those huge amount of data, we need a quantum computers to give you an idea of what will going to happen and will give you a probability of output. So, if you are going to start a company and if you are going to have a huge number of customers, well, you can surely afford a quantum computing, but it costs more.
Thank you, Mr. Rajai. And here is your next question. And the question is from Rakesh. Question is, do quantum computers have any specific operating system to work on, or do they operate on existing operating systems?
Yeah, I can explain this, I think so. Ajay, can I explain it?
Okay, before explaining, Mr. Mohammed, okay, I will send to that email. Thank you. Carry on, Bhupu.
Okay, now you people have to understand that quantum computers fundamentals basics and classical computers fundamental basics are totally different one. So, here we use OS like called, we can take Intel i7, i9 for example, we can take different types of OS, Windows 10, something, anything else. But quantum computers fundamentals and the classical computers fundamentals are entirely different one. So, you cannot have the operating system as same as what we use in classical computers. Quantum computers have their different types of fundamentals and basics, and it has different types of processing. It does not, you cannot compare it with classical computers on operating system. You cannot compare any quantum computer with classical computer. I think you got an answer, Mr. Rakesh.
Thank you, Mr. Gokul. And here is a general question for you both. How have you developed your area of interest in learning matter and energy?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Pardon me?
Yeah, sure. How have you developed your area of interest in learning about matter and energy?
So, if I'm not wrong, someone is asking, how did I get an interest to know about quantum and energy?
Yeah, of course.
Right from my 10th standard, I have a friend circle. The circle is more or less like work while work, play while play. So we used to discuss a lot of things. Every Sunday we used to have a get together. We'll have a healthy conversation. But I heard about quantum computing through one of my college junior from second CACC called Vino. He suggested me. Since we both are in async, he recommended me to go with quantum computing. So that's where I started searching and reading about quantum computing.
So,
thanks, Mr. Rajan.
In my point of view,
thank you.
So, in my point of view, to be very frank, I am not a technologically interested or passionate person. But when you have a friend like him, I said, Mr. Ajay, whatever a conversation you start with, it can either be an entertainment, concepts you can chat with. If you chat with him, you will have a knowledge and you will gain knowledge. You will end up the chat by discussing something about technological only if you chat with him. So, thereby I got an spark of studying about quantum computing by chatting with my friend called Ajay, and this is the true thing.
It really sounds good. Thank you. And here is your last question for you both. Can quantum computing applied with AI? Can be applied with AI?
Yeah, it has a very large area of application in artificial intelligence. Okay, Gopal, proceed.
Yeah, you can explain, and after you explaining, I can explain what my point is, Ajay.
No, carry on.
Yeah, quantum computing has a huge area in artificial intelligence. So you can Google also said that quantum computers going to be a vast application in using it for the applications of artificial intelligence, and quantum computers can even make artificial intelligence very easier to understand from a commoner's point of view and from a student's point of view. It can make artificial intelligence easier to study also. They have claimed that.
Also, adding to the point, even giant companies like Amazon and Google have made a model of quantum computers, and now they are using it live in real life application. They use the quantum computers, they give the input of all their users, and they will get a probability output in which area, what are the products, if they sell, it would benefit them. You can calculate this even in a classical computer, but when you mix it with AI, and if you get the probability output for a particular area, that would really make a huge impact, since you get the result in a very short span of time.
Thank you, Mr. Ajay, and thank you, Mr. Gokul. And now I wholeheartedly invite Mrs. Gayatri, Assistant Professor CSC, to deliver a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Sharmila. So today's session was very awesome, and you both made all our participants to involve and concentrate more in your conversation about quantum computing. That too from its beginning. I also told us about comparison between classical and quantum computers and why do we need in terms of their security. And most importantly, you both have shared the algorithms used for the efficient processing. And also the picture and the video you both played were really nice to understand the concepts more clearly. So I would like to appreciate both of you where you both came as a volunteer to give this kind of a webinar to our student friends. Thank you both, Ajay and Gopal. I wholeheartedly thank our department to give us this opportunity to conduct such a wonderful students webinar session for our students to explore their ideas and share their knowledge to other students. Once again, I thank you all for your active participation. I would require the same support from all of you for the other days too. Thank you.
Before concluding, management, faculty members, especially Sampath sir and Gayatri ma'am for their continuous efforts. Also thanks to HOD ma'am and the management for giving us this wonderful opportunity from myself and behalf of my friend Gopal. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much for your words, ma'am. It means a lot. I thank the Lord HOD ma'am, Sambat sir, Gayatri ma'am for organizing this superbly, and the students also who interestingly joined this session and made a quite interactive session with us. So these type of activities will be encouraged more in our future coming days, and it will be more if we can gain more knowledge on this if we have student webinar session more on our future days. Thank you so much, everyone, ma'am.
I would also like to thank my friend Sachin for helping me with the PPT. I also thank for a very good MC. Thank you, Sharmila.
Thank you.
Yes, my your feedback link has been posted in your chat window, so you can use of it. Then you can fill your feedback form. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.